Hello to you friends, this is yet another guided forest sangha meditation out in the jungle. As you can hear, the insects are very happy today. Heavy rain tonight and now sunshine, that's what they like. The forest monk is also happy, so now we're gonna take the last fourth Brahma-Vihara, the last infinitely divine dwelling, namely equanimity, Upekkha. The four divine dwellings, the four infinite states, are, as we remember, one, universal friendliness, two, endless compassionate pity, karuna, first is metta. Three, infinite rejoicing joy, mutual joy in others' success, mudita. And four, equanimity, serene balance, impartiality, upekkha. Upekkha is thus one of the four and the last one of the four divine states. It is also the tenth and the last mental perfection, Upekkha Parami. And it's also the last and most refined link to awakening, step to awakening, factor to awakening, Sambhuyanga, Upekkha Sambhuyanga. So this equanimity, this Upekkha, has an important role in all Buddhist virtues. Why is that so? Because it actually refines and completes all the seven steps to enlightenment, the seven links to enlightenment, the seven wings to enlightenment, which are one, awareness or mindfulness, sati, two, investigation or curiosity, Dhamma Vijaya. Three, energy or enthusiasm, virya. Four, joy, piti. Five, tranquility. Six, concentration, samadhi, and seven, upekkha, equanimity. So equanimity refines all these states. As we discussed earlier, then early Buddhism is a rational philosophy and science in the sense that it builds on causality, of cause and effect, also regarding mental states. So what is the cause and what is the effect of equanimity, of upekkha? The cause, the feeding cause of equanimity is the law of karma, seeing the law of karma, which is like this. This is this mnemonic device, this remembrance that one has to have in mind. It goes like this. All beings are born, created, and formed by their karma, by their past intentional actions, by their behavior, basically. They are owner, inheritor, and debtor to their karma, to their actions, to their behavior, to their intentions. Whatever they do, good as bad, only they will feel the resulting delayed effect thereof. Seeing that makes this equanimity arise. It is good both when one is attacked by external circumstances. This can be other beings or unfortunate circumstances. Then one remembers this stanza, all beings are born. If it's other beings, then one can understand, whatever they do now, they will feel the result of it. I don't will feel the result of it. Whatever they do towards me now, may be the result of my prior karma. So it helps to endure attacks. It also is a moderating ability that cuts off all partiality, both for this or that group, this or that culture, this or that religion, or against this or that group, this or that culture, this or that religion. So it's completely impartial. It also assures that any excess on one side, too much of whatever, or on the other side, it also ensures and prevents any deficiency. So it keeps to the middle, neither too much nor too little. Keeps to the moderating middle of all things. Majja, majjatatta, the moderating middle of all things. Thereby it ensures the golden middle way. Thereby also regarding emotional responses, it is, since it is neither gladness nor sadness, it is neither pain nor pleasure. So it kind of like prevents being attracted to things, but also to be repulsed by other things. And thereby, as a feeling, it neither arises any desire when contacted by a pleasurable object, nor does it arise any aversion when contacted by an repulsive object. It just stays in the middle and looks on. It looks on without any emotional reaction. It is indifference, but not in a cynical way, not in a negligent way. If it succeeds, then it enables peace, a sense of peace. If it fails and one becomes unaware of it, then it is subjectively felt as boredom or negligence. So this indifference, one has to be aware of it. So it's felt as being undisturbable, unaffectable, unprovocable, immune. Because it is like this dancer, when equanimity sees all these things, all these constructed things, all these conditions, phenomena, arise and cease, come and go. Then it say, this is gross, this is primitive. All these conditions, constructions that arise and cease. But this equanimity, this is peaceful, this is exquisite. And so whatever conditions there is, internally or externally, pleasant or painful, past, present or future, material or mental, then equanimity just takes its stance right there to see that these phenomena are conditioned, they are constructed, they are impermanent, they are passing, they are a form of transience. No need to take it serious, to be engulfed by it, but still one just keeps being aware of it, without reacting emotionally towards it. So there are equanimity between internal states, material as well as physical. A material state internally will be a disease. One has a cancer or whatever. An internal mental state will be joy or sorrow. So one becomes indifferent towards both. Similar with all external states, material or mental states, live beings running around, they are doing this or that. Immaterial things such as mountains, oil rigs, military weapons, and so on. One becomes indifferent towards these also. So one becomes detached, so to speak, towards mental states and all material states, whether internal or external. One becomes detached, indifferent, unaffectable by all painful, pleasant or neutral states. Thereby one becomes wholly immune. One is still aware of it, but one doesn't react upon it. And thereby the mind dwells unagitated. It's not stirred up by anything. Normally it stirs up by pain and pleasure. Then it starts running after pleasure and running away from pain. But this is not the case when equanimity takes its stance and say, ah, this also is constructed. This also is conditioned. And this also is therefore impermanent. This also is therefore suffering. No need to take it serious or to become personal about it or to cling to it. So equanimity is a very detaching ability. The highest detachment is this equanimity. What is the effect of equanimity? Is knowing and seeing, jnana dasana, knowing and seeing. And since knowing and seeing is what knows, first it knows the objects and then it sees it. Once you think it's otherwise, first you see the object and then you come to know it. No, because you only see what you look for. Whether it's internal mental states or external mental states or material states here or there, past, present and future, you only know it if you have kind of a reference frame to look after it for. Then you see, this is also constructed. This is also conditioned. This is also a formation. Therefore, ultimately speaking, suffering. And therefore, ultimately, something that wants you not detached to, cling to, or aversively try to get away from, push away. So, this nanadasana, this knowing and seeing, then sees all this phenomena in samsara, internal and external. It just sees it, and then it knows it, under the reference of the Four Noble Truths. Seeing and knowing him as suffering. And if one craves for him, then this suffering arises. And it ends if one stops craving for him. And the Noble Eightfold Way is to the method to end this craving. Then it sees all these objects, whether jungle or city, whether human or not, friend or enemy, they see his eyes constructed. It is suffering. And then it detaches from it. So, pleasant feeling then doesn't give rise to lust, and painful feeling doesn't give a rise to aversion, repulsion. So it is something that one should cultivate. How does one cultivate it? One cultivates it by sitting in the morning and say, ah, may I and all beings on the 31 levels experience, meet, and express this exquisite equanimity. May all beings in this city, in this country, on this planet, in this universe, experience this ultimate, imperturbable serenity of equanimity. May all beings become aware of equanimity. May all beings examine equanimity. May all beings become energetic and enthusiastic with training this equanimity. May all beings become joyous by this equanimity. May all beings become silent and tranquilized by this equanimity. May all beings become concentrated, focused and absorbed into this equanimity. May all beings become imperturbable by this equanimity. This one spreads out then in the front, to the right, to the back, to the left, above as below, to all beings in this entire universe. Then gradually this equanimity will set in. Again, the cause of equanimity is seeing and knowing and repeating this stanza. All beings are born of their actions. They are created by their actions. They are formed by their actions. They are conditioned by their actions. They are owner, inheritor, and debtor to their karma. Whatever they do, good as bad, only they will feel the future result thereof. This is the cause of equanimity. effect of equanimity, again, is knowing and seeing. Jnana dasana, which leads to disillusion, which leads to detachment, which leads to mental release. So knowing and seeing is three steps short of enlightenment itself, because enlightenment is the same as release, mental release from all objects and states. So it cannot be expressed how important it is, at the same time also how agreeable it is when one is aware of it. If unaware of it, then it is experienced as boredom. But if aware of it, then it's experienced as something very agreeable, very peaceful, very stabilizing. It is a factor of jhana, of the third jhana, where one stays in aware equanimity. And in its ultimate refinement is the fourth jhana. Trained over a long time, this will give access to the formless jhana of nothingness, of voidness, of emptiness in the future. So it has profound effects beyond the immediate detachment from emotional overreaction. So much for today on the fourth Brahma-Vihara, Upekkha, equanimity, serenity. Undisturbable, imperturbable mental balance, evenness of mind. Thank you for your attention and have a nice day. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Indeed. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.